Well, what a privilege to be here in the presence of Jesus today with all of you. Wonderful to see you. And this is your first service. Don't let it be your last. It's very important. If you call this your home church, it's very important for you to be here. The Lord is shifting this body. The Lord always shifts his body. John said this. He said, if we walk in the light as he is in the light, then have we fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus cleanses us from all of our sin and all of our unrighteousness, meaning that we're going to see him differently in the light at different times. It's kind of like a prism. When the sun shines on a prism, the light, which goes very, very fast, is refracted into that prism, and you turn it and you see different images of light that come out of that. And what I mean by that is, if you see Jesus in the Bible, we see him the first time in the scripture when he's in the earth. We see him in Mary's womb. But he didn't stay there, did he?
Right.
He was in the light as the babe in Christ, or the babe in Mary's womb. Then we see him the next time, he's in a manger in Bethlehem. But he didn't stay there. The body shifted. The Lord moved the body out of the manger. The next time we see him, the light turns again, the prism turns again, and we see him 12 years old in the temple in Jerusalem, astounding the Judaizers, the lawyers, the teachers of the law. But he didn't stay there. The body shifted again. The next time we read him, he's locking the door on the carpenter shop. He's moving to the Jordan River, and he's baptized by John the Baptist. And the Spirit of God, through an open heaven, comes, fills his life with power that he may do the works of his Father. He's not going to live anymore as Mary's son. Now, from that point forward, everything he does will be done as the Son of God, not the son of Mary. But he didn't stay in the Jordan River, did he? Shifts again. We see him walking the dusty cobblestone roads of Judea with those hillsides down Jerusalem streets. We see him entering into different homes. We see him entering into different cities. He's healing. He's raising the dead. He's preaching the gospel. He's healing the leper, doing all of those things that he said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me to do. But he didn't stay there. The prism shifts again. We see him on a cross. All of Jesus was there, right?
Yes.
Every part of his body was on that cross, but he didn't stay there. I'm not at the cross today. I'm not there because he's not there. The body shifted, put him in a grave. We see a lot of his followers coming to the grave there to mourn their Savior. They thought their trust had been betrayed. But I'm glad to tell you the body is not there in the grave anymore.
Amen.
The angel said, you're not going to find him here. The Lord is risen indeed. You're not going to find him here. Where you found him before, he's not there anymore. But I'm glad to tell you, ladies and gentlemen, the body didn't just walk the earth for 40 days and 40 nights after he rose again, showing himself alive by many infallible proofs. That body was raised into newness of life, and he sits at the right hand of the Father today. What I'm saying is, this body has shifted since Friday night. And some of you may feel awkward in here today, but it's not the same body. The last time you came to touch this body, the body of Christ, it's not the same anymore. It's not in the same place. It has transitioned to another place. And that's why it's important. If you're a member of this body, a member of his body in particular, it's important that you shift with the body. Isn't that right? Because here's what's going to happen. Mary was sad. She went to the last place she saw the body, and her heart is broken. And now she's confused about what's going on. The body is moved. She thinks somebody stole it. Oh, they took my church away from me. I want to go back to our little church. I want to go back to what our church used to be. It's not going to be that again. You can forget that. It's never going to be that again, because it's not supposed to be that again.
Amen.
Cleopas and the disciples walking down the road to Emmaus. Their hearts are sad. That sadness got into the cadence and the march of their walk. Jesus joined them. What is the manner of your communications? You're sad. Their shoulders are slumped. Haven't you heard? Are you a stranger in Jerusalem? They didn't recognize Jesus. They didn't recognize the shift. Are you a stranger in Jerusalem? Have you not heard? We put our trust in this man, and now we've heard that he's alive. This is the third day since those things have happened, been 3 days. We don't know if this is true or not. But Jesus brought them in. He quickened their pace. He took them from the cross and took them beyond the grave and brought them into the power of resurrection. Oh, fools and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Ought not Christ to have suffered and then to enter into his glory? And before it's all done, though their heart is burning and they've moved out of that slowness, they moved into the quickness, the quickening of the resurrection of God. Amen. So I'm telling you today, folks, it's important for you not to miss anything. When that man of God, the pastor of a local church, says that the Lord is calling us aside for days to be set apart to meet together, and you say you're a part of this, and you can be here. And I know sometimes jobs and different things like that can interfere. But if you can be here and you willingly absent yourself from this, you're going to miss the work of the Holy Spirit. You're going to miss the shift, and it's going to feel strange. Jesus is going to feel like a stranger to you, where he should be familiar. If you would have been here in the flow, you would have been right in. Now, I say that to say this, that if you haven't been able to be here in all of this, the Holy Ghost can bring you up to speed today. Christ is going to bring you up to speed today. If you're willing to come out of where you saw him last and be willing to be translated and transformed into where he's at now, he's going to give you grace to come into this present place where this body is. Brother Aaron, I can tell you under God, this body is going to shift so quickly over the coming days. Amen. You're going to be astounded. And if you're not in the Holy Ghost, you're going to miss that. This body's going to shift, and we're about to shift out of here completely.
Amen.
If the whole body of Christ was involved in everything that he did, I can tell you this, the whole body of Christ is going to be raptured.
That's right.
The whole body will be translated from here to there. It will be, because it's a body thing. And it's beautiful. And that's really been an emphasis point of the Spirit, the nature of the body, the quickening, the working of the body together. And I just thank God for that. This has been such a joy of ours to be here. We thank God for your kindness and your generosity. And I appreciate your giving. This church has always blessed the evangelist. I've been the recipient of that. You've always blessed the evangelist. And I know you'll always bless the evangelist, because that's your pastor's heart. I thank God for pastors like Brother Aaron that will allow the office of the evangelist to operate without inhibition. I have felt no limitation here. I felt nobody pulling on my coattail. Don't go there. Don't go there. Don't say that. I haven't felt that one time. I have felt absolute liberty behind this pulpit, and I know Brother Bill feels the same way. And I believe this, folks, that when you receive a ministry in the name or the character of that ministry, you receive the reward of that ministry. It's what Jesus taught. If you receive a prophet in the name of a prophet, what happens? You receive a prophet's reward. Same thing, pastor, all the way through, apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, teacher. When you receive it in the character that it's sent by the Lord. And remember, if you reject me, you reject him that sent me. Jesus said that. If you reject your pastor, you reject him who sent him, which means you're rejecting Jesus. So it's important that we hear. And I would say that if I wasn't holding the microphone today, I would believe that setting right over there if Brother Bill Casey was up here. He has blessed my heart. I have received from God. I've received from the exhortation. Pastor, thank you for what you said today.
Amen.
I mean, everything that's been preached and talked about, Brother Aaron said even before the meeting started, but since we've been here, everything that's been said, spoken, and done, this man of God has verified that, validated that. Out of the mouth of two or three witnesses, let every word be established. Well, I'm glad to be here today. I feel the burning of God. I feel the fire of God in my heart. I want to tell you what that fire is. Our God is a consuming fire. You know what that is? That's his passion for us. That is his love for us. The burning of God. How many times have we, sinners don't come, or if they do come, they're really almost scared to death to be among the people of God, because we told them, if you come, God's going to get you. He's a consuming fire. You're going to be a crispy critter before you get out of here. That's the way we made people feel. Listen, what if we presented God like this? That God's going to get you, but it's going to be like a parent that sees their child moving toward danger, and they run over and they get them and rescue them from the danger they're about to be involved in. Why? Because their heart is burning for that child. Could it be that the burning we feel today is our God burning for us? He has come to get you today, but he's come to rescue you. He has come to envelop you in his arms of love, and that is his burning. And that's why John the Baptist said that when Jesus comes, he would baptize us with the Holy Ghost and with fire. Amen. The fire burns up stuff, yes, but more importantly, that's the love of God. Because you can't make a proper judgment about what is right and what is wrong without love. Because love allows you to love what God loves and hate what God hates, what God hates, in the way that He loves it, in the way that He hates it, right? So I feel that burning today. Our God is a consuming fire, and He is here to consume this church in His passion. Amen. Amen. That's the only reason I'm going on, because God first loved me, and that gives me the right to love Him, gives the ability to love Him. And I do love Jesus, and I'm not ashamed, and I found out dignity is not a fruit of the Spirit. Isn't that right? Dignity is not a fruit of the Spirit. Our Jesus is a rejoicing Christ. He's rejoicing over us today. I believe He's dancing over His people. I believe He is just declaring our name before our Father. He's not sitting up there. I can tell you, folks, God's not in the sour mood we think He's in. Amen. He's just not. If you'll please me, I'll do something. No. No, He's already done something. Amen. He's already done it. He's already done it. And now I'm moving in that, and it's a joy. I tell you, I'm more in love with Jesus than I've ever been in my life. He's the greatest lover I've ever had. He is my lover. I feel His embrace. And I tell you, He believes in PDA. How many of you know what PDA is? Public display of affection. If you don't know what that is, PDA. Public display of affection. He's into that. I am too. I like to hold my wife's hand in public. I like to kiss her in public. I do. I like to hug her. She's not much on that stuff, but I am. I like that. And I tell you, I'm into PDA when I come to church. I love to worship Jesus. I do. I love to worship Him. His arms are open toward me, and my arms are open toward Him. And I love that. I'm going to express my love to Christ because He first loved me. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I hope the rest of you like PDA. Well, that's just not me. Well, it's a new you. That is the new you. That's the inner you. Amen. Yeah, Brother David, I just worship the Lord in my heart. Then that's not true worship. Because the Bible says that real faith, believing, is believing in your heart, but confessing with your mouth. Right? Amen. Believing in your heart, confessing with your mouth. In fact, that self, to come to church and say, I'm just going to worship in my own way, when God has dictated to us the way to worship Him. In spirit and in truth. That's self. That's self to say, I'm just going to worship in my own way. You have no right to do that. No right to do that. I have no right to do that. I'll just pray in my own way. I don't have a right to pray in my own way. There's a Bible way. There's a scripture way to worship, scripture way to pray, Bible way to have church. And when you believe on Him as the scripture has said, what happens? Out of your belly flows rivers of living water. That's how it flowed. Well, that didn't cost you a dime, okay? Everything I've said up to this point, you didn't pay for that. I appreciate the food you brought in, ladies and gentlemen. Maybe some men have cooked too. It's been wonderful. Brother Bill says, he's been saying this, he said the ministry has been growing by leaps and pounds. I like that. That won't be the last time I say that. That's good. That's good. I want you to stand with me this morning. We're going to go to the book of Daniel, the third chapter. Daniel chapter 3. I want to begin at verse number 25. And I want to speak something that I know to be the heart of God for this service today. I know it's for now. I know it's for this moment. So you're hearing the will of God. Brother Bill taught us yesterday about the feet of the ministry, that the ministry is feet. And I pray we won't be defeated anymore. Amen. I pray that we will hear. Where did Mary sit? At His feet and heard the word. So I want you to gather with me today at the feet of Jesus. I represent those feet. Ministry is feet. Let's gather there today and let's hear what Jesus is going to speak to our hearts, because I know it's for everybody in this room. You can't shovel this over your shoulder and say, boy, if they'd have been here, he'd have got them. You're here. You're God. God's going to talk to you. So let's read this today. Daniel chapter 3 and verse number 25. He answered and said, lo, I see four men. This is Nebuchadnezzar now. He said, lo, I see four men loose, walking in the midst of the fire, and they have no hurt. And the form of the fourth is like the Son of God. Then Nebuchadnezzar came near to the mouth of the burning fiery furnace and spake and said, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, ye servants of the Most High God, come forth and come hither. Then Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego came forth of the midst of the fire, and the princes, governors, and captains, And the king's counselors, being gathered together, saw these men, upon whose bodies the fire had no power, nor was a hair of their head singed, neither were their coats changed, nor the smell of fire had passed on them. Then Nebuchadnezzar spake and said, Blessed be the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who hath sent his angel and delivered his servants that trusted in him, and have changed the king's word, and yielded their bodies, that they might not serve nor worship any god except their own God. And I want you to jump back up to verse 27. The last phrase says, Nor the smell of fire had passed on them. And I want to preach this morning with the help of the Spirit, the absence of the smell of fire. Father, we love you today. Just join me in prayer right now. Just worship the Lord with me. Father, we are so grateful to be in your presence. You are a God that has expressed your love openly. You have done more than verbalize your love to us. You loved us so much that you gave your only begotten Son, that whosoever would believe in him would not perish, but have everlasting life. It was a public display of affection. And Lord, your continued blessing upon our lives, the infilling of the Holy Spirit, the baptism of the Holy Ghost in fire. Lord, that is your love in public being displayed to and upon us and through us. And I thank you for every blessing, for the blessings that you are granting to us in this moment that we have together. We love you for it, Lord. And it's with joy that we approach your throne. It's with boldness that we come before you. And we say, Welcome, Holy Spirit. Be the anointing to preach in this house. Be the anointing to hear in this house. And be the anointing to obey, to assimilate these truths in our lives. Be that in us. Be the faith of the Son of God in us. Be the love of God in us today. Shed it abroad in our hearts, that we will speak with that love and that we will receive the love of the truth as it's given to us today. Supply every need. Work in every heart, we pray, not only here but back in the children's church. Manifest yourself there, Lord. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Everybody shouted amen and amen. You can be seated. There really is something supernatural that is occurring in relation to our trials. As it was for the Hebrew children, doesn't it seem that our struggles are becoming hotter or more difficult than they have been in the past? I can't speak for you, but I can speak for me. Bible said back up in verse number 19, it says, Then was Nebuchadnezzar full of fury, and the form of his visage was changed against Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Therefore he spake and commanded that they should heat the furnace 17 times more than it was wont to be heated. That tells us that the degree of difficulty can change in our trials. And the more that God moves in to display himself, then we can rest assured that our trials are going to become more difficult in their degree of difficulty. But also we see that the outcomes are more glorious. It seems like there is more blessing and there is more revelation and there is more growth, i.e. there is more promotion in what God does and the outcome of those trials. Verse number 30 says, Then the king promoted Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the province of Babylon. That is the outcome of the way God works in our lives. When we move with him correctly, when we allow and embrace the purpose of the trial to end up with that purpose being fulfilled, then promotion is the outcome. God promotes us. We are trusted with more authority. We are given more revelation. We are given more influence as individuals and as a local body of Christ. Now, we don't get to pick and choose the nature or the magnitude of our test. If I could, I wouldn't have picked some of them for me. I'll be honest with you. I would not have picked some of the things that God has chosen for me to go through for my life. But God chose them. What I chose to do is either glorify him in that trial or try to preserve myself. That's where our choice comes in. We don't choose the test. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego chose to remain faithful to God when pressured to bow to Nebuchadnezzar's golden image, and the trial was chosen for them. They did not choose the trial. They chose faithfulness. They chose to love God. And therefore God and the enemy in conjunction together chose the trial for them. Understand today that the choosing of us by Jesus and his ordination for us to go forth and bring forth fruit transcends what the trial can do to us. The fruitfulness of Jesus doesn't change because the trial gets worse. Our ability to bring forth the image of Christ doesn't change because the trial gets worse. Why should I say that? Because the fruit is the fruit of the vine. It comes through the branch, but the fruit is the fruit of the vine, and the hotter heat we face cannot make his fruitfulness non-existent. Jeremiah said in Jeremiah 17, 7 and 8, blessed is the man that trusteth in the Lord and whose hope the Lord is. For he shall be as a tree planted by the waters and that spreadeth out her roots by the river and shall not see when heat cometh. Isn't it good to know that we can see Jesus and not the heat? Isn't it good to know that we can be oblivious to the flames if we choose to focus on the Son of God? There was a time walking on the water, Peter was oblivious to the storm, but when he became storm conscious, he lost Savior consciousness and gravity took over. It's possible for the Holy Spirit to keep our focus upon Jesus in such a way that we are oblivious to the flames and only live in the glory of God. You shall not see when he cometh, but her leaf shall be green and shall not be careful in the years of drought, neither shall cease from yielding fruit. I want to say it again. The hotter the trial, the greater the fruit of Jesus if we'll walk with him in that trial. His fruit transcends that. Now what this means is that just as Jesus was in his trials, so are we in our trials. You've got to get that. Just as Christ was in his trials, so are we in his trials. Sister Melissa shared with us today the way Jesus was in some of his trials. Jesus forgave from the cross. Sometimes we get bitter in our trial toward other people, but Jesus forgave in his cross. Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. He put Mary and John together in his cross. It happened from his cross. He gave his mom away to John and gave John away to his mother, and then they became spiritually a family together. Only Christ can do that. He refused pain-deadening drink from his cross. I'm going to go through this all the way. I can't allow one iota of this pain and suffering to be deadened. I have to suffer it all. If I'm going to do it all for my people, then I've got to suffer to the zenith extent. And that's exactly what he did. Would you agree with me that he saved a thief from the cross? He saved a man from the cross, brought him into the kingdom of God. He prayed prayers of ultimate commitment to his Father. Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. That's his fruitfulness. That's who he is. The cross did not change him. The cross magnified who he was. It magnified his love. It magnified his commitment to the Father. And that is the purpose of God in our trial. His nature and presence are preceding and fruitful facts. They have gone before us. He's already been there. Well, nobody's ever gone through what I've been through. He has. He's been there. And because he has suffered for every man and like every man, he is now a faithful high priest that can be touched with the feeling of our infirmities. Because he endured the temptation and did not succumb to sin, now he is able to succor them that are tempted. He knows how to offer aid and help. In fact, I can tell you that his nature and presence and fruitfulness are mobile and transferable realities that do not pick and choose what trials they commit to. If we don't get to pick and choose the trials that we go into, I can tell you the fruitfulness of Christ is in that trial, because it doesn't pick and choose what trial it's going to commit to. If you're in it, he's there today. Come on, somebody. I said, if you're going through it, he is there. He didn't pick and choose what things he's going to come and help his people in. He's committed all of it. Hallelujah. Every one of them. He is there. So they also are proceeding and fruitful facts. Listen, Jesus said, I am with you always. You believe he meant that? Yes. I am with you always. That's not just a verse to help you when you're going through trouble to make you feel better. He said, I'm committed to you. I am committed to you in a storm, in a furnace, in a palace, on a rocky barren island. I am committed to you. Lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. He is there. We've been talking. How many times have we heard praying through, presented in such a way it almost seems impossible to get there? We make God on the other end of a desert, and we're on the opposite end of the desert, and there's rocks and there's cactuses between us and him, and we got to crawl over the rocks and we got to go over the cactuses, and it's got to hurt and it's got to be pain to get through. Listen, I got up this morning, I didn't have to pray through to God. He said, I'm with you always. I am in you. I am with you. I got up this morning feeling fine. I got up this morning with worship in my heart. I got up this morning feeling good about God and knowing God was feeling good about me. I may have to pray through through answers. I may have to pray through to the manifest presence, but I never have to pray through to find God. He's found me. He lives on the inside. And that's why I can tell you today, he is in your furnace. He is in your trial. And the fruitfulness of himself will manifest in that trial. The way he was in his trial is the way you can be in your trial. Come on, somebody. It's no different. It's no different at all. He is in your furnace. The choice to be spiritual wasn't made by the Hebrew children when the trouble came. I knew you wouldn't shout there. We got too many four-leaf clover believers. When they get in trouble, oh God, help me. Oh, you don't love him one iota before then. You could care less if he's in your life or not. But you let trouble break out. They're going to get the horseshoe out. They're going to get the rabbit's foot. They're going to start rubbing. Oh, God. I'm not saying he won't answer that. He will. It's always right to turn to Jesus. It's always right to come to him. But I can tell you this, folks, if you really want him to manifest and you want promoted in your life and you want the glory of God to manifest in your life, then you've got to determine that I'm going to be spiritual before trouble comes. Because the Hebrew children made the choice to be faithful to God, and it was made prior to the furnace. That determined the outcome of the furnace for them. This also meant that the fourth man's choice to be in the furnace wasn't a last minute decision either. It was made prior to the furnace, and this determined the outcome for him as well. Listen, folks, when God told Noah, as a man told me this at a car lot, we're shopping for cars, my wife and I, and there's some people that I grew up from, you live right down the road, and it's a town 50 miles away, but they're there, and a man told me, he said, Brother David, God didn't tell Noah to go into the ark. He said, come thou and thy house on the ark. If he would have said go, would have meant God was back there telling him to go in there. But when God said, come thou into the ark, God was in that ark, and he's saying, come and join me in there. You understand what I'm saying today? I'm telling you, if the fourth man wasn't in the furnace before they got in there, the moment they got in there, they're dead meat. But Jesus was in there waiting on them. Hallelujah. I said the Son of God was in there waiting on them, because they made a choice prior to that moment to be spiritual and to be faithful to God. You reap what you sow. If you sow faithfulness, you'll reap the faithfulness of God in your life. He will be there. Are you hearing me today? He's there waiting on you in that trial. Hallelujah. We have to grasp the fact, if he wasn't in that fiery furnace, they're done for. He didn't come in 5 minutes later. He's there waiting on them. He's there waiting on them. Faithfulness is not a choice of convenience. It's a choice of covenant. Woo. Faithfulness is not a choice of convenience. It's a choice of covenant.
Amen.
Oh, that makes a man Pentecostal right there. I know there's going to be a rapture. My spirit man's trying to get out of my body right now. Faithfulness is not a choice of convenience. Some of you, you're only faithful when it's convenient. Jesus is faithful to you because of covenant.
Amen.
That's exactly right.
Covenant choices are founded in love and eternal purpose. Just as Jesus keeps you, He is also keeping His covenant promises to the Father and to you. That's why He's keeping you. He made a promise to the Father, and He made a promise to you. I'm going to keep you. I'm going to walk with you through the great things in life. I'm going to walk with you through the heartbreaking things of life. I am there with you. You're going to go through waters, but you're not going to drown. You're going to go through the fire, but those flames will never kindle upon you. What a promise. What a covenant. What a God. Stephen stood for Jesus prior to the stoning based on covenant love. Why would Stephen face those Judaizers and tell them about Christ like he did? Because he loved Jesus and he knew Jesus loved him. But listen, because he was willing to stand prior to the stoning, he realized that Jesus was standing for him prior to the stoning. He didn't see Jesus standing up after the stone started flying. He saw Jesus because he's full of the Holy Ghost. He's looking steadfastly up into heaven, and he sees Jesus standing at the right hand of God. That's prior to the stoning, ladies and gentlemen. That's Jesus making good on his covenant love. In fact, that word standing in the Greek means covenant. He said, I see the Lord covenanting for me at the right hand of the Father. Hallelujah. That's what the writer of Hebrews said. He stands in the presence of God for us. I know we preachers want to stand up and point our finger at people and say, we need to stand for God in this end time. But I'm going to tell you, it's not about us standing for Him. It's knowing He's standing for us. If we can see Him standing for us, we will have the endurance to go through every single thing. And the fruitfulness of Jesus manifested in Stephen. Father, don't lay the sin to their charge. That's the nature of Jesus, as Jesus was in his trial. Now Stephen could be in his trial. Put your hands together and give him glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Our posture in a trial can be adjusted to and by the presence of Jesus. Look at verses 21 and 23 of Daniel 3. It says, then these men were bound to their coats and their hose, bound in their coats, their hose, their hats, and their other garments, and were cast into the midst of the burning fiery furnace. Listen to verse 23. And these three men, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, fell down bound into the midst of the burning fiery furnace. Anybody ever crumbled at the initial stages of a trial? I have. I've gone through stuff before, and the way I characterized it, Pastor Aaron, was I told people, I said, my knees buckled. I'm not going to lie to you.
Amen.
It just come out of nowhere, and then it seemed to come out of everywhere. And the brunt of that thing and the blow of that thing, you just, it almost seemed like you fell down. But they didn't stay there. That wasn't their posture for the duration of the trial. Well, glory to God. These men were down initially in the trial, and they were wearing things that were fire hazards in the trial, but they didn't get themselves up. They didn't loose themselves. They didn't start the victory march through that fiery furnace. The Son of God did that. The fourth man did that. I've gone into a lot of my trials initially flat on my face. God, I can't take it. But when it's all said and done, that fourth man got me up and he said, David, walk with me. March with me through this trial. So I know some of you are saying today, I'm going through hell. Listen, that would have been hell had the fourth man not stripped that flame of its fury and its ability. You may feel like you're going through hell today, but I can tell you there's not a flame of hell that's kindling upon you right now, because Jesus Christ has made a decision, has made a choice. I'm going to get you up when you feel weak, and I'm going to make you strong. You may go in bound, but I'm going to loose you, because I want you to walk in here with me just like I'm walking. That flame's not affecting me, and if you'll stay with me, that flame will never affect you either. Come on, lift your hand and give Him glory today. Hallelujah. 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 Jesus did that. The Son of God did that. The pre-incarnate Christ did that. And they lived in the furnaces he did. In the way the pre-incarnate Christ secured them, we see the sufficiency of grace. I want you to hear me right here. We see the sufficiency of grace. I went through a trial in January. If you would have been here last night, you would have heard the story of how last year was one of the worst years of my life. I battled in my mind emotionally, mentally, as never before. I've never had my confidence in God and in my call come under any greater attack than what it did last year. God brought me through that. When January came around, there was one more open, blatant attack, and the Lord overcame that. But later on in the month, I was in ministry up in Arkansas in a church. It's a great church like this one, as a young pastor like this one, a congregation of wonderful peer, different peer groups just like this one. And I get a call. Our family gets a call. The call actually didn't come to me, but it affected everybody in our family. It's one of those phone calls you never believe you're going to get in your lifetime. You believe this stuff will never happen to your family. And I'm talking about it was an issue that could have put hatred in my heart. And had I not been sanctified by the Lord, had it not been Jesus in my life, it's a kind of stuff that perhaps in time you would want to see that person not live any longer. That's how egregious the difficulty was. And I never thought about that like that way toward this individual that wounded our family. But I was in that revival meeting, and we get that phone call, and that shock came as a result of that issue. My knees buckled. I'm not going to lie to you. I'll use that term in that trial. My knees buckled. I fell down underneath the weight and the shock of that issue. My heart was broken. I couldn't cry. I was so heartbroken. I was just astonished. I thought about the people in my family that were affected by this and how possibly they could have been affected by this. And my heart was breaking. And I wanted to go get the ones that it affected. And I wanted to hold them so tightly. But I went in my office at home and I began to seek the Lord. I said, God, I've got to face people tonight. I have to minister this word of God. And Lord, right now, the way I feel, I can't stand before them. I can't do it. I need you to talk to me. I need you to do something in my spirit, because my heart is breaking and I feel weak in my life. I tell you, Jesus was already there. Jesus was already there in that trial, and I'm going to prove it to you. He told me that day in my office, he said, David, my grace is sufficient for you, and my strength is made perfect in your weakness. I opened up my Bible to 2 Corinthians chapter 12. And I begin to read those words that Jesus said to Paul. He's prayed 3 times about the thorn in the flesh. He would have prayed 30 times about it had the Lord not answered him, because Paul wanted an answer. He was seeking the Lord for an answer. But after 3 times, Jesus answered him, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. And Paul's response, most gladly therefore will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Verse 10, he said, therefore I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in necessities, in persecutions, in distresses for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then am I strong. And I said, Lord, I hear you saying that into my spirit. But how does that work? How is your grace sufficient? How am I going to see that manifested in my life? And this is what he said to me. He said, David, my sufficient grace is not just substance that I give to you, but it operates as an element of substitution. And I said, Lord, I need you to explain that further to me. He took me to the fiery furnace. He said, David, those 3 Hebrew children were in that fire, and that flame was real. But the intention of the enemy to inflict pain was never realized, because I was in there with them.
Yeah.
I'm full of grace and truth. And because I was in there, you got to remember, folks, substitution is the basis of our redemption. He took our place. The pain that was inflicted for us that would have took us out, Jesus bore that for us. And I can tell you in your trial right now, if you live and walk in the grace of God, what could possibly take you out, what could create bitterness in your life, will never touch you to that capacity, because Jesus now, as the grace of God to you and the strength of God to you, will shield you from the full brunt of that flame, and you receive His strength. Yes, the thorn was real, but it never caused Paul to be so weak he couldn't move on in ministry.
Hallelujah. Praise God.
You understand what I'm telling you right now?
Yes.
That's sufficient grace. It's substitution. And the Lord would tell me later on, we get to February, that thing's still kind of fresh in my mind. And I'm in Florida, like I told you last night. Florida's a good place to be in February. Come on, Nebraska folks, you know what I'm talking about. That's a great place to be in February. And I'm there, I'm preaching a camp meeting with another minister friend of mine. And the Lord said to me in Florida, He said, David, what you thought was a wall, because that thing looked like a wall. It looked like it was going to boom and repel me backward. He said, what you thought was a wall was nothing more than a speed bump. He said, I'm going to get you over this so quick, it's going to be like it never happened. Woo! It's going to be like it never happened. You know what a speed bump is? It slows you down, but it doesn't stop you. You slow down, but once you're over it, you're back up to speed again. And listen, that man of God that I was preaching with got up on the platform with me, and he knelt down and put his arm around me. And the Lord spoke to me through my friend, and he said, David, I already see that the enemy is regretting what he's done to your family. I'm here to declare to somebody, the enemy is already regretting what he's done to your family, because the grace of Jesus is sufficient. You're not going to stay down. He's going to get you up. You're not going to stay bound. He's going to set you free. You're not going to be inhibited by the flames of that fire. You're going to walk around in liberty. You're going to walk around in grace. You're going to walk around in strength, because the grace of the Lord and the strength of the Lord is keeping you. It's substituting for you where it can take you out. Glory! Hallelujah! 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 I want to tell you how you're being kept. And we're getting close to the end here. I want to tell you how you're being kept. You're being kept by the power of God. But it's the power of love. How many times do you picture, well, I'm being kept. See, we think because we're barely hanging on, that's how God's doing it. He's just barely hanging on, and the last thread is fraying. Well, any moment now, I go over in this dark chasm, and I'm going to be lost forever. I'm going to be destroyed forever. He's going to let me go. And I was reading the Song of Solomon, and the Lord, He came to challenge that image in my mind. He said, David, I want to tell you, I'm not barely keeping you. I'm not barely keeping you. My power to keep you is not, if you do something wrong, I'm going to turn loose and let you go in there. He said, I'm keeping you by love. And He took me to the Song of Solomon, chapter 2 and verse 6 and chapter 8 and verse 3. The Shulamite young lady says, His left hand is under my head, and with His right hand He doth embrace me. In chapter 8 and verse 3, she says, His left hand should be under my head, and with His right hand He should embrace me. And he said, David, I want you to realize that. That's an embrace of love. That's how I'm keeping you. I'm keeping you by my love. I'm not barely hanging on, ready to turn you loose at any moment. I'm holding you like a lover. Is anybody hearing this preacher today? I'm holding you like a lover. I am in love with you. I am holding you with my love. Listen to me. Under means instead of. Underneath your head. In the place. That's substitution, isn't it? In the place of your head, you're going to find His hand. In the place of your thoughts that are frail, you're going to find His hand. In the place of your mind that's under attack, you're going to find His head. I'm not standing here holding this microphone with victory because I'm super spiritual. I'm here today because I've been kept perfectly by the love of my God. Hallelujah. And with his right hand, he doth embrace me. Embrace means to clasp the hands together. Picture his hand under your head, and that right hand's running around your body, and they're holding together like that, forming a seal to hold you in. It's almost like a picture of a mama holding a baby. Caressing you, carrying you. That's our Christ. That's our Lord. You're not barely hanging on. You're not that's a devil trying to deceive you to make you believe you're about to go over the cliff. You're not, ladies and gentlemen. He is caressing you. He is working in your stead. He is in the place of you today. His life is in you. Listen, I want to close with this. This is what we get to today, the absence of the smell of fire. The enemy doesn't have to incinerate you, however, to diminish the testimony of Christ in your life. He only has to mark you with the residual effect of your trial. He only has to mark you with a residual effect of your trial, with a hint of fire, and the whole outcome has been changed. You know, it'd been great. Whether clothes didn't burn up, they got all their eyebrows. Eyebrows didn't burn off. Their head has all the hair. All their skin's in place. But if they would have came out and somebody would have said, "You've been through something, hadn't you?"
Yeah. There you go.
That would have changed everything. I tell you, you get around some people, it doesn't take long to... There's some bitterness there. There's some cynicism there.
Come on.
They're not letting something go. Yeah, you may be the other side of it, but that thing's marked your life forever. I smell fire. Because when you get around them, they're not talking about the victory. They're talking about the failure. They're not talking about what God's done. They're talking about what their spouse did, or their children did, or their boss did, or they did. That thing's marked your life forever. I smell fire. You've been through something. And better yet, that something's still in you. And it's still affecting your life. Smells matter, don't they? Come on, Nebraska folks, you know what I'm talking about. Silage night. Well, I smell like traveling on. I smell those feeds a lot. There's some people in here today, you've got cynicism since you've been through stuff. You become cynical. There's some bitter people sitting under the sound of my voice today. I wasn't going to preach this, by the way. Had something else I was going to preach. Holy Ghost just came on me. You'll deal with that today. You'll deal with the smell of fire today. Bitterness. Some of you have become critical. You were never critical before, but now you're critical. About God, about people, about things. Listen, you wasn't pie in the sky. It wasn't that you just believing the glass was half full. You were just a yes and an amen person because that's the promises of God. But you're not that anymore. You're a no and no way person now. You're critical. Some of you have developed a victim mentality. Listen, this is really going to speak to somebody. Some of you have fear now of a worse thing coming upon you. You've been through something really tough, but now you're afraid something worse is coming. That tells me the trial has marked you. I was there, brother, sister. I'm not going to lie to you. Last year when I coming through that mental thing, there was fear that just enveloped my life, and I just knew something worse was going to happen. I'm creating all of these scenarios in my mind for my life. Some of you have decreased in your fellowship and ministry with the Lord and to others. It's marked you. You backed off. You used to sing. You used to pray. You used to testify. You used to be in the altar, but you're not here anymore. I smell fire. I smell a fiery furnace on you. And the Holy Spirit has come today. I'm ready to wash all of that away. I tell you, His grace in this end time, folks, it's like that trial never happened in my life. Amen. That thing last year, that thing in January, it's like it never happened in my life. I've been through so many things. It's like that. I know what happened, but that grace is substituted where my pain should be. And I'm over that speed bump. And I'm moving on with God. Listen, let Him heal you today completely and fully. The testimony of Christ is you come out reeking with Christ. You know what the anointing is? It's the Holy Ghost smearing Jesus all over you. Head to toe. I smell the rose of Sharon. I smell the lily of the valley. I smell the bread of heaven. I smell living water and just that scent of water.